Would you stand with us? God has brought us here this morning, each in this room, to be with Him, to learn from Him, to sing praise to Him.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds Thy hands have made, and I see the stars, and I hear the rolling thunder, Thy power. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art.
seated.
Morning. Welcome to the church at West Franklin. Thank you for choosing to worship with us this morning, whether you're here or online at home. Make sure you check out the e-bulletin. I want to talk about just a couple of things really quick. Vacation Bible School is coming up in a couple of weeks, so if you haven't signed up yet, for your kids, your neighbors, the kid at the grocery store, whatever, sign them up. We would love to have them. If you are volunteering, we have a volunteer training this afternoon at 4 o'clock, so make sure you come to that.
And you might be aware of the current COVID crisis happening in India. And while that's happening on the other side of the world, there's an impact here at home. Just a couple weeks ago at our family gathering, we had a couple attend that found out this week that they have a family member who contracted COVID in India. And so as we pray for healing, let's not forget the people that are here that are also hurting for their family members and friends. So far, we've been able to give over $50,000 to the Bangalore Hospital to help with resources and supplies, as well as $2,500 to national church planters who have contracted COVID. So your giving doesn't just impact our community, but it impacts our efforts around the world. So let me encourage you to continue to pray and to continue to give. Let's pray together. Father, we come to you right now to lift up the nation of India. Father, we pray for healing and restoration of physical bodies, Lord, but we also pray that you would reveal yourself to them and that you would show yourself as the one true God. God, as we come now to worship and to give, Lord, may you be glorified. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Man, would you stand with us? Big shout out to my kiddos for being well behaved while both mommy and daddy were on stage. Thank y'all so much. Thanks, yes, makes it so much easier. Okay, so we're standing up, we're in a room together, but have you looked around to acknowledge that we are in a room full of other humans? Would you take a minute? Just look around, make eye contact with somebody, wave at them. We are here together to hear from God. Good. Thank you for doing that. It is so good for us to remember we're humans together. We are promise breakers. We do so much ill, but God is a promise keeper. He will lead us to goodness, let's sing it together. Promise maker,
promise maker, promise keeper, you finish what you begin.
Our portion, our provision, let's sing it.
Our provision through the desert, you see it through to the end. Darkness, you will lead us
This song is a reflection on God's character.
Let me sing. You call the sun to rise, and you lay it down to rest, and you hold this heart of mine, and you hold my every breath. You're such an awesome God, so then sings my soul. Came in and we sang that song. I pray that the problems we brought in all of a sudden felt so small in light of who you are. I pray that turning our eyes to you has been a balm to our soul as we've sung your praise. Pray that our heart is ready to receive now from your word. That's why we're here, Father, is to be with you, to hear from you, to learn from you. And Father, I pray you would make yourself known even now, in Christ's name. Amen. Please be seated.
In a time of loneliness, on the outside, looking in, death was all that surrounded, and grief, my only friend. Then, you called my name with gentle words and patient love. What a breath of fresh air. This is redemption.
Good morning, West Franklin. Let's continue worshiping. I encourage you to take your Bibles and turn with me to the third chapter of Ruth, the third chapter of the Old Testament book of Ruth. I'm going to read the chapter in its entirety. It's only 18 verses, but as you'll see, it is a thick plot and it's very, very good narrative and very rich reading. So I'm going to read all 18 verses. Hopefully you've got time to find it. If not, it's going to be on the screens behind me here. So let me encourage you to stand in honor of God's word, please, and follow along with me as I read this chapter aloud. Ruth chapter 3, beginning with verse 1. Ruth's mother-in-law, Naomi, said to her, "My daughter, shouldn't I find rest for you so that you'll be taken care of? Now, isn't Boaz our relative? Haven't you been working with his female servants? This evening he will be winnowing barley on the threshing floor. Wash, put on perfumed oil, and wear your best clothes. Go down to the threshing floor, but don't let the man know you were there until he has finished eating and drinking. When he lies down, notice the place where he's lying. Go in and uncover his feet and lie down. Then he will explain to you what you should do." So Ruth said to her, "I will do everything you say." She went down to the threshing floor and did everything her mother-in-law had charged her to do. After Boaz ate, drank, and was in good spirits, he went to lie down at the end of the pile of barley, and she came secretly, uncovered his feet, and lay down. Is it hot in here? Whew. Thank you. Just read the text. Verse 8, "At midnight, Boaz was startled, turned over, and there lying at his feet was a woman. So he asked, 'Who are you?' 'I'm Ruth, your servant,' she replied. 'Take me under your wing, for you are a family redeemer.' Then he said, 'May the Lord bless you, my daughter. You have shown more kindness now than before, because you have not pursued younger men, whether rich or poor. Now, don't be afraid, my daughter. I will do for you whatever you say, since all the people in my town know that you are a woman of noble character. Yes, it is true that I am a family redeemer, but there is a redeemer closer than I. Stay here tonight, and in the morning, if he wants to redeem you, that's good. Let him redeem you. But if he doesn't want to redeem you, as the Lord lives, I will. Now lie down until morning. So she lay down at his feet until morning, but got up while it was still dark. Then Boaz said, "Don't let it be known that a woman came to the threshing floor." And he told Ruth, "Bring the shawl you're wearing and hold it out." When she held it out, he shoveled 6 measures of barley into her shawl, and she went into the town. She went to her mother-in-law, Naomi, who asked her, "What happened, my daughter?" Then Ruth told her everything the man had done for her. She said, "He gave me these 6 measures of barley because he said, 'Don't go back to your mother-in-law empty-handed.'" Naomi said, "My daughter, wait until you find out how things go, for he won't rest until he resolves this today." Jesus, would you give us ears to hear and eyes to see? Open the eyes of our heart to where we see what you're doing and why you put this story in the Bible. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. Really wrestled with how to approach this text. There's so many different angles you could take. On the one hand, I thought, well, let's look at, okay, how Ruth and Naomi are kind of on the edge of a new season, and there's some great nuggets of truth here of how you glean wisdom or how you approach what's God's will for the next season. And I thought about that for a little bit, but I thought, you know, that's fine. There's some nuggets you can take away from this text regarding those things about seeking God's will for the next season, but that's not really the heart of this passage. And then I thought, well, there's some really good stuff here about how to approach someone of the opposite sex with wisdom, with character, with self-control. And there's some nuggets we could take away from that in that regard. But honestly, I don't think that's the heart of the passage either. And so I really, as I began to say, okay, why did you put this in here, God? Why is the story of Ruth here? I honestly believe the story is here to help us understand more of the heart of God. I believe that's why it's here. I believe this is a real story that happened to real people to mirror the real heart of the real God. You've heard me say before, and I'm quoting someone, I don't know who said it, but he was really smart. You've heard me say before that the most important thing about you is what comes to mind when you think of God. Period. I believe that's true. The most important thing about you is what comes to your mind when you think of God. If you think of God rightly, it will impact how you live your life rightly. If you have a wrong understanding of God, that will negatively impact your life. And so I think one of the reasons this passage is here, the main reason this passage is here, is to help us see the heart of God. Honestly, as I look at the story of Ruth and Boaz, this kind of steamy chapter, and how it reveals to us how God interacts with his people, I'm thinking the most bizarre memory came up into my mind. It was an article I read recently out of GQ magazine. Now, I don't subscribe to GQ magazine. I know you probably think I do, because I look the part, but it's not funny. I don't subscribe to GQ. Somebody pointed me to this article, and so I read it. And wait for it, it's an article about Justin Bieber. I was reading and studying Ruth chapter 3, and I thought of Justin Bieber. Pray for your pastor. Honestly, it's an essay about Justin Bieber written in GQ magazine. The title of the essay is called "The Redemption of Justin Bieber," written by a guy by the name of Zach Barron. I guess he writes all the time for GQ. Again, I'm not a normal reader. But I thought it was fascinating, this thing. Now, whether what happened to Justin Bieber is real or not, I don't know. Not for me to judge. But I was captivated by this article, and I wanted to read to you a portion of it. The author writes, when Beaver was about 15, he met a pastor named Judah Smith who runs a church called Church Home. Beaver meets a lot of people. Most of them want something from him. Years went by as Beaver did whatever he was doing, and Smith remained in his life, if not particularly close. When Beaver finally began to merge out of his bad years, and if you know anything about Beaver, bad years. When he began to finally emerge from his bad years and seek guidance, Smith, the pastor, was still there. And Beaver noticed that in retrospect, Smith had never asked him for anything. He put our relationship first, Beaver says, and then he started to notice other things too, like the way the Smiths' family seemed to care for one another. It was something I always dreamed of because my family was broken, Beaver says. My whole life I had a broken family, and so I was just attracted to a family that eats dinner together, laughs together, and talks together. That sense of belonging, of care, of stability, Beaver came to recognize it as the thing he wanted but never had. I came to a place, he says, where I was just like, God, if you're real, I need you to help me because I can't do this on my own. Like, I'm struggling so hard. Every decision I make is out of my own selfish ego. So I'm just like, what is it that you want from me? You put all these desires in my heart for me to sing and perform and to make music. Where are these coming from? Why is this in my heart? What do you want me to do with it? What's the point? What is the point of everything? What is the point of me being on this planet? And the author says, and what happened when Beaver asked for help is that someone or something answered. He suddenly had a certainty. Beaver says, if God forgives me and loves me and he sets these things in motion, if he puts these desires in my heart, then I'm going to trust him. Now, church, I don't know if Justin Beaver was really redeemed. It says a lot about my heart if I don't think the gospel's for him too. But you know what fascinated me about this? There came a point where Justin Bieber laid it all on the line and said, God, if you don't fix me, I can't be fixed. If you don't rescue me, I can't be rescued. He finally looked outside of himself for help. Now, the author of GQ says, what happened when believer? Don't stop believing. What happened when Bieber asked him for help is that someone or something answered. The author of GQ, secular magazine, from what I can tell, this isn't Christianity Today. What's interesting is that if you read the article, Bieber makes it plain what happened to him. Jesus happened to him. Now again, I don't know. I can't read his heart. But it's a fascinating take. And what I love about it is that it's a picture of what happens when we cast ourselves on the Lord and say, if you don't help me, I'm doomed. If you don't fix me, I can't be fixed. Think about Ruth. Ruth is now in Bethlehem. She started out in Moab. That's where she's from. So through some horrible circumstances, ended up with her mother-in-law back in Bethlehem. She's a Moabite. She did not look like Israelites. She didn't talk like Israelites, like the Israelites. She didn't grow up worshiping the same God of the Israelites. If you read your Bible, you know Moabites were cursed by God because of their rebellion. The Israelites hated the Moabites. So here's Ruth, not looking anything like any of these people she's now with. She's a widow. She's childless. She has nothing. Her future looks bleak. And if somebody doesn't come and help her, she has no future. It sounds a lot like my soul. And if you have ears to hear, it's probably a lot like your soul. Spiritually speaking, I am cursed by God. I have said to God over and over, I don't want your plan. I don't want what you say. I'm going to do it my way. That's sin. I don't deserve a seat at the table. I don't look like holy people. I don't talk like holy people. If you don't fix me, I ain't getting fixed. And it's exactly what's going on in Ruth chapter 3. It's a beautiful story. It's a real story that really happened to real people. And it's here, I believe, to point us to how God treats those who don't deserve a seat at the table. Let's pick it up again in verse 1. We're going to go through it again. We're going to go quick. Don't worry. You don't have to pack a lunch. Here we go. Verse 1. Ruth's mother-in-law, Naomi, said to her, "My daughter, shouldn't I find rest for you so that you will be taken care of?" Let me pause there. The word rest in the original means whole, means full life. It's barley season. It's over, meaning I don't know what we're going to do after this, and you don't have a future. It's not looking good, so we better start doing something, sister or daughter-in-law. So I'm gonna do something. Now, the text doesn't say this, but you can't help but wonder if Naomi's also wanting grandbabies. I don't know, but perhaps there's some grandbabies being wanted here. But she says, I want to take care of you, so I'm going to put something into action here. Verse 2, now isn't Boaz as our relative? Haven't you been working with his female servants this evening? He will be winnowing barley on the threshing floor. Wash, put on perfumed oil, and wear your best clothes. Go down to the threshing floor, but don't let the man know you were there until he has finished eating and drinking. And when he lies down, notice the place where he's lying. Go in and uncover his feet and lie down. Then he will explain to you what you should do. So Ruth said to her, "I'll do everything you say." Now, I think we might need to pause here and let's get some culture and context going home, because this is weird. Okay, it's the end of barley season. Naomi knew that Boaz, their relative, is going to be celebrating the end of barley season, praising the Lord, gathering all of his workers in the field and saying, you know what, let's rejoice because barley season's over. And obviously it had been a very successful season. And then Naomi says, "Hey, I want you to go wash, put on some smell good, and then go put on some nice clothes." Now, when you and I read that, we're like, go ahead, Naomi. We're saying, go ahead, put on that little red thing for Boaz. When we read, that's what we think. But we've got to put ourselves in the context of the Old Testament. Hear me. Ruth had lost a husband too. She had been wearing grief clothes. Clothes that expressed she was in a period of mourning. A season of grief. Naomi is letting her know it's time for you to communicate to the world that you are past the mourning period and you are now available for marriage. Okay, she's not telling her to go put on something little red thing. She's telling her to dress as if you are beyond the grief period. Now, in Old Testament time, this is so weird for us, for me anyway, an older man would never propose to a younger woman. That was a huge societal no-no. You just don't do that. Today, if a man wanted to marry a younger woman and he didn't propose, we'd call him a wimp. But in Old Testament times, that was not the culture. If a younger woman wanted to marry an older man, she did the proposal. And so what Naomi is telling Ruth to do is go and make yourself demonstrate that you are now available for marriage to Boaz. And you say, well, tell me about this feet stuff. It gets even more weird. That's how they did proposals in this age. They went at night, uncovered feet, hoping that feet would get a breeze and startle them, and they would see a woman lying down at the edge of the place where he was lying down. That's so bizarre to me, but I got to tell you, church, I'm so glad we don't do that anymore. I'd have never gotten married. I hate my feet. My feet are horrible. I kept them covered until she said yes. And by the way, I hate your feet, so don't post pictures of them this summer at the beach. I don't want to see them. I don't want to see them. I'm so glad they don't do it. But in Old Testament days, when you made a proposal, that's what you did. It's bizarre, but think about it. Proposals have changed over the years. If you've been married 20 years or long or over like I have, I mean, think about it. How much proposals have changed just in the last 2 decades. Katie and I, when we got engaged, we actually had to drive home, get out of the car, and walk in the house to tell my parents. Today, if you get engaged, before the bride-to-be says yes, everybody knows it. It's all over. It's a huge event. Proposals change all the time. Hundreds of years ago, you uncovered the dude's feet. Okay, let's keep reading. Verse 6. She went down to the threshing floor and did everything her mother-in-law had charged her to do. After Boaz ate, drank, and was in good spirits, he went to lie down at the end of the pile of barley, and she came secretly, uncovered his feet, and lay down. At midnight, Boaz was startled, turned over, and there lying at his feet was a woman. So he asked, "Who are you?" "I'm Ruth," your servant, she replied. Take me under your wing, for you are a family redeemer. Pause. A couple things. Again, end of barley season, celebration time. Boaz would have been around a lot of people rejoicing, partying, giving glory to God that the barley season was successful. I want you to notice something. Boaz obviously did the threshing work with his employees, with his guys. I love his work ethic. He didn't go tell them to do it. He did it with them to get in the crop, to make sure it's all done. But also notice this. Where does he go at bedtime? He goes to the threshing floor. He doesn't go back home and get a room to his bedroom by himself. He didn't get a room at the Holiday Inn Express. He is at the threshing floor, at the end of the threshing floor. Why does the author tell us that? Because even though this was an intimate moment, there were still people that could hear. There were still witnesses, so to speak, if anything got out of line, if anything got out of hand. And remember, this was the time of the judges. In the time of the judges in Israel, everybody was doing what was right in their own eyes, which means most, 99% of the men were jerks and would abuse women. So Boaz could have gone to his house, could have gone to his own bedroom, could have gotten a hotel room, but he didn't. He's at least still out in public, if you will. And Ruth says, did you catch that? It's me. It's Ruth. You're my relative. Let me come in, be a part of your family. You're a family redeemer. Real quick, before we move on, we need to identify what family redeemer is. Your translation may say kinsman redeemer or guardian redeemer. If you take time to read the book of Leviticus, and if you're bored this afternoon, go read the book of Leviticus. It'll bless you. If you read the book of Leviticus, you'll find out that a kinsman redeemer, a family redeemer, was a very specific thing that God put into place, and that's this. If a husband and wife were married and the husband died, the brother of the deceased husband was charged to be the kinsman redeemer. And what that meant was the brother of the deceased husband would now buy, purchase, redeem the wife, children, land, and take it as his own to carry on the family line. Huge deal. Huge deal. It was a huge act of, you will now come under my wing. I will now promise to protect you. I will promise to give you a future and make sure you go on and we will carry on the family line. If there was no brother, the next in line was the family redeemer. So Ruth is saying, hey, you're a relative. You're our family redeemer. And man, she's putting it all out there. So get this, church. You have a very powerful, rich, influential Israelite man in the time of the judges named Boaz. And he has a Moabite woman, a foreign widow who's childless at his feet. If you're an Israelite reading this or you're a Moabite reading this, the tension is thick. Is he going to tell her to get away? Is he going to abuse her? Is he going to punish her? Is he going to be angry at her? How is an influential Israelite, a powerful, wealthy Israelite, going to treat this Moabite woman? And right now, I hope your soul is saying, how does God treat someone who doesn't deserve to be there? Watch what Boaz does. Verse 10. Then he said, may the Lord bless you, my daughter. You've shown more kindness now than before because you have not pursued younger men, whether rich or poor. Now don't be afraid, my daughter. I will do for you whatever you say, since all the people in my town know that you are a woman of noble character. Yes, it is true that I am a family redeemer, but there is a redeemer closer than I am. Stay here tonight, and in the morning, if he wants to redeem you, that's good. Let him redeem you. But if he doesn't want to redeem you, as the Lord lives, I will. Now lie down until morning. So she lay down at his feet until morning, but got up while it was still dark. Then Boaz said, don't let it be known that a woman came to the threshing floor. Think about this, church. Let me just pause there again. Think about this. The first thing, I mean, she puts herself out there and says, I don't have a future. I don't have anything to offer you. I am a Moabite woman who's childless and a widow. What does he say? What's the first thing out of his mouth? May the Lord bless you,
my daughter. May God bless your soul, daughter. May God shower your life with abundance, daughter. Get this, church. You may think it's weird that he's calling her daughter. No, get this. What he's doing is saying, don't refer yourself to a Moabite anymore. Don't think of yourself as cursed anymore. Don't think of yourself as just a helpless foreign widow anymore. I'm calling you daughter because that's what you are. You're a daughter of God. You're a child of God. I am making you a part of the Israelite family from the line of Elimelech. He is saying the first thing out of his mouth, the Lord bless you, my daughter. And he calls her daughter again. In the time of the judges, we had a man of integrity, of setting the table of kindness, of gentleness, of graciousness, making it safe for Ruth, say, the Lord bless you, my daughter. And some of you right now need or long for the Spirit of God to say that to your soul. May the Lord bless you, my son. Guess what? Ruth didn't make herself a daughter. Boaz did. You can't make yourself a son or a daughter of God. He does it. By the way, in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, all three gospel writers record a story of a woman who had a medical condition where she was bleeding for 12 years. It couldn't stop. She went to all the doctors, tried to get it fixed, couldn't get it fixed. She couldn't have children. She was considered unclean because of the blood problem that she had. She heard Jesus was in town, and she thought, if Jesus can't heal me, nobody can. And so she walked up, and she touched the hem of his robe. He took her uncleanness. He made her clean. And you know what the first thing he calls her? Daughter. I really want to put a parenthesis here and preach a sermon on how dads need to refer, how they identify their daughters, what they say over their daughters, what they communicate over their daughters, because what you say about and to your daughter matters. Just read Ruth and Naomi, the transformation that happens because they believe the identity that Boaz gives them. Close parentheses, that's another sermon. Boaz makes it safe, is kind, is gracious, is gentle. And he also does things with integrity and character. Did you notice the plot thickens? If you read this, if you're like me, I'm like, no! Because Ruth put it out there and Boaz is like, listen. And we don't know it because the author hadn't told us yet, but you can kind of feel something's going on between Boaz and Ruth. And Boaz is like, I am a family redeemer, but there's one closer. Now, he could have just brushed it under a rug, but he wants to do things with integrity and character. He's got to put his head on the pillow at night before the Lord. There's one closer. And I just wonder if Ruth was like, no, he's probably fat and hairy and ugly, and this is awful. I don't want him. I want Boaz. I don't know. But I just wonder. I just imagine this guy. Hey, I'm the family redeemer. I got to stop because that's not in the text. We don't know. We just don't. I just imagine Ruth like. But Boaz is doing things with integrity and says, there's someone closer than I am. I need to go ask him. I don't want to give the story away. You can read chapter 4. But I think you know how it ends. Now, let's close the curtain on this chapter. Verse 15. And he told Ruth, bring the shawl you're wearing and hold it out. And when she held it out, he shoveled 6 measures of barley into her shawl, and she went into the town. Before she left, he said, Let me give you some barley to take back. Now I'm not up on my barley portions, okay? I'm not schooled in barley. But apparently, from what I can tell in commentaries, this was a load. This was like Costco-sized barley. Like here, this is. Take some barley back to your mother-in-law. Notice what he says here, verse 16. She went to her mother-in-law, Naomi, who asked her, what happened, my daughter? Don't you know there was like 50 other questions, but that's what the Bible tells us. What happened, my daughter? Then Ruth told her everything the man had done for her, and she said, he gave me these 6 measures of barley because he said, don't go back to your mother-in-law empty-handed. Naomi said, "My daughter, wait until you find out how things go, for he won't rest until he resolves this today." I love that. He didn't give just Ruth the barley, but he says, "I want you to go home and give it to your mother-in-law." Why? Because I don't want her to be empty-handed. Why is that significant? Because if you remember in chapter 1, Naomi came back to Bethlehem and she said, "Don't call me Naomi, call me bitter. I've lost my husband, I've lost my two boys, and I've just came back with this Moabite foreigner who's my daughter-in-law. Don't call me Naomi, call me bitter, because I went away full, but the Lord brought me back empty." And Boaz says, take six measures of barley because your mother-in-law, Naomi, is not empty anymore. She's going to have an abundance. It's going to overflow. That's a picture, church, of the Christ. These things happen, yes, sometimes. Sometimes they don't in our normal everyday lives. You say, well, you know how the story ends. It's a beautiful story. It's like a fantasy. It's like almost seems too good to be true. You think, well, this is beautiful. But what does this have to do with us? It doesn't always end this way. If you have ears to hear, yes, it does. Because this is to teach us what happens spiritually when you say to God, "I don't deserve a seat at your table, but I can't fix myself. If you don't help me, I'm done." And the first thing he says, "May the Lord bless you, my daughter. May the Lord bless you, my son." As a matter of fact, you can't become one of his children unless you say, "I can't do it anymore." And he's not going to smite you. He's not going to abuse you. He's not going to push you away. He's not going to punish you, because all the punishment you deserved and I deserved, he laid on his son, Jesus Christ. All of it. And so he can say to you, "The Lord bless you, my daughter." Some of you, that's your story. That's your story. You can look back and say, "Yes, that's who I am." Not just when you were in eight years old and you prayed a prayer, but every day. That's your story. Oh my goodness, I don't deserve. You're gonna redeem me. You're gonna make me part of your own. You're gonna give me a future. You're gonna give me a hope. You're gonna give. Yes, yes. Some of you, your souls are saying, "That's me. That's my story." Others of you, it can be your story. If a Moabite, cursed of God, foreign widow, childless woman can throw herself before an Israelite man in the time of the judges and get treated like that, that's there to say anyone can cast themselves on the grace and mercy of God and receive it. It can be your story. And the Lord can say over you, "The Lord bless you, my son. The Lord bless you, my daughter." All you have to do is believe. Now, some of you are thinking, "Okay, I've trusted Jesus, but I'm ready just to be with him. I'm ready just to be with him." Can you imagine what it was like for Ruth that next morning when she was wondering, "Oh my goodness, what about what's the other kinsman going to do? What's he going to do?" What does Naomi tell her to do? Something we all hate. Wait. He's going to take care of some things, but he's not going to put it off. You wait right here. He's going to come back and y'all are going to be together. I don't know this. The text doesn't say it, but I just wonder if Naomi was like, "He'll be back. Now you go put on that red thing." No, I'm just kidding. "He'll be back." One of the greatest phrases in the English language is "keep your fork." If you grew up in the South and had a grandma that could cook, you loved hearing "keep your fork." Because that meant you just had an incredible meal and somebody just took your plate and Granny said, "Keep your fork." And you know what "keep your fork" means. Somebody done baked a pie. You just had an incredible meal, but you need to keep your fork because it's about to get better. I loved it when Granny said, "Keep your fork." It was about to get good. What does a Christian do between now and the time Jesus takes care of things and he comes back? Keep your fork. going to be together. And it's going to be so good. That's what Ruth said. Naomi said to Ruth, just wait. You'll be back. And then you'll be together. I'm going to pray, and then Brad's going to lead us in another song or two. But I want to invite you to respond. This was a gospel-type message. It reveals the heart of God for us. Not just once, but all the time. And I want to invite you to respond to that. Some of you, you just can't believe that he can look over you and say, my daughter or my son. I want to help you with that. I want to help you understand that. So after I pray, I'm going to be standing right here while Brad sings. And I've asked Kelly Davenport, our children's minister, to join me and stand right here. And I want to invite you, if the Spirit of God is stirring in your heart, to come and say, would you help me understand more of this? I want to trust Christ. Maybe you want to come to these steps on the side or come to one of these front row pews and just pray. Spend some time praying, saying, thank you, God. Help me understand who you are. Help me have a right understanding of who you are. But as the Spirit of God leads, obey him. Follow him. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the beauty of it. Thank you for showing us over and over and over again how you work. Lord, this was a real story that happened to real people. And it's a beautiful story, but it's here, I believe, to again give us a taste of your heart for your undeserving people. May we receive it, embrace it, live out of it, and be transformed for your glory and our good. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Church family to acknowledge what God is doing in our heart. As we sing, these people are here to help, and this altar is open. But put motion to what God is doing in your heart this morning, at this time. happens in the waiting.
You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty to ashes. You turn shame into glory. Into highways, you're the only one who can. You're the only one who can.
So you turn morning,
you turn morning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame.
Quick, before we dismiss, I ask Kelly to join me on stage here. 4 years or so ago, Kelly, her husband Jeremy, and their three kids started visiting our church. And so their kids are about the same age as mine, and I found out they're from the great state of Alabama, and then I found out they were Auburn fans. I was like, these are quality people. I need to get to know them. And I say Alabama fans or Auburn fans? Okay, good. Got to correct that. So I said, you know what? I want to take Jeremy to lunch. And so I asked him to lunch, and we went, and I got to know him. He got to know me. And towards the end of the lunch, I just kind of said, tongue in cheek, really joking, I don't guess your wife's looking for a children's ministry position, is she? And he didn't laugh back. I fully anticipated him to be like, pfft. And he said, I don't know, she might. And the next thing I know, we're emailing and I'm contacting Kelly. And before you know it, we realized that God was calling her to be our children's minister here for the next season. One thing you need to know about Kelly is when I began to talk to her and she came, she was very clear to me that she did not believe God had called her to full-time Christian ministry. She had heard me talking about the calling God placed in my life and other ministers, and she said, I love that. I'm glad you have it. I don't think I do. And I said, well, yes, you have. You just need to tell God that he's called you to Christian ministry, because I just so valued her work here. But she said, she and I just, as we had discussions, said, God has you here right now. I believe as long as he has you here, he will equip you, he will enable you, and for this season, call you. And my goodness, has he done that. God has used Kelly in tremendous, tremendous ways. She has been true to herself, knowing that, you know, as she told me in January, that the season's come to an end. There's different life stages, different life things happening, and it's time to pass the baton. But she's been true to West Franklin. There are many, many children, many, many parents who love the God of the Bible because of Kelly Davenport. She has worked hard, she has loved us well, and she's done an incredible job. I don't want to see her go, but she follows the Lord, and if the Lord's leading her to do it, then she's got to be obedient. So Kelly, West Franklin loves you. We're grateful for you. And her last Sunday, the reason I'm telling you this now, her last Sunday is next Sunday, so I want to give you time today and throughout this week and next Sunday to let her know how much you appreciate her. So why don't we just thank God now for her with our hands and just... express our appreciation. Jesus, I know that you have looked over Kelly's life and said, "The Lord bless you, my daughter." She believes that and she lives in that. And she has helped many of us and our children hear that. And I pray now for the next chapter, for her, her family, that you would continue to bless them with your presence. Thank you for how you have used her to bless us. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day.